Boca Juniors, River Plate,
Diego Armando Maradona, El Mundial.
All these names have made the history of football, or soccer as Americans call it. It's great to have here at Michigan State a young PhD student who is studying the relationship between some of these football clubs and Argentine society, Alex Galarza. So Alex, tell us about your research.
Well, my interest in Argentine soccer really comes from the link between soccer and society. So as a first generation American, I was very used to the idea of having a club kind of call to your identity, your way of being, something that excited you, something that you took very seriously. But one of the things that I was struck with very quickly in Argentina was that the clubs, in addition to all this this energy around them, they had a very strong presence in the everyday life of the city. So one of the things that I look at is, how do Argentine clubs affect the daily practices of the city? What's the relationship between urban space that the clubs were part of constructing, the very urban fabric that they helped weave, and the social relations that took place in that urban setting? So I look at actually soccer in the mid-20th century in Argentina. That's this moment where clubs have already transformed into these everyday sites of sociability, of politics, of economics. They've transformed very quickly in Buenos Aires from places where young men got together to form a team and compete against other teams into places where an entire neighborhood, an entire community was conducting their everyday lives. So beyond soccer, you had other sports being practiced, basketball, volleyball, but also social activities and leisure activities. So you had knitting clubs and dancing groups as well. Kind of what urban life was supposed to be about in a lot of ways was under the umbrella of soccer clubs. So they were much more than clubs very quickly. And in this mid-20th century moment that I look at, what happens is a lot of these clubs start to respond to a new type of consumption pattern. And so I look at projects that soccer clubs were involved in where they garnered political support, economic support, and fan support to transform the urban fabric once again and shape consumption patterns.
And one of the most important ways, of course, that soccer clubs shape the urban landscape, not just in Buenos Aires, but everywhere around the world, is through the construction of stadiums. And one of the fascinating aspects of your work that I'd like you to say a little bit more about is this grandiose project called the Ciudad Deportiva in Buenos Aires. Tell us a little bit about this.
Sure. So my research, its central object of study is this project by Boca Juniors called the Ciudad Deportiva, or the Sports City. And this is really a hybrid between a stadium complex and a theme park and a sports complex. So one of the things that Boca Junior was trying to do was that at this point, Boca and River, the classic rivalry that many of us know about, they have garnered national attention. They're more than just Buenos Aires teams. And in this interview, one of the presidents of Boca Juniors, Alberto Armando, who the current stadium is named after, La Bombonera, he talks about River Plate being the number one social club in Argentina, but Boca being number one in terms of soccer. And so the Ciudad Deportiva was going to be the centerpiece of launching a new era of Boca Juniors history, where they became much more a part of their everyday experiences in the city by having this sports complex, this theme park. And it was monumental. They planned on constructing a 150,000-seat stadium. It was supposed to be the site of the 1978 World Cup final, which ended up being played in River Stadium. The project was never completed. So part of the project was this mega stadium, but also 18 tennis courts, a drive-in movie theater, mini golf, new types of leisure and recreation that didn't traditionally fall under the umbrella of soccer clubs. This is the beyond athletic factor that was targeted for a middle class consumer. And so I used the Ciudad Deportiva to launch into a greater discussion about how clubs were involved in culture, consumption, and urban space in the city at a very particular time in Argentine history, after Perón has left and after the city is being reimagined both by the government and by people as a space that should look more middle class.
Shall we take a look and see what the Ciudad Deportiva actually looked like in the plans?
Sure.
Okay, one of the interesting things about Alex's work also is that he's doing it not just the conventional way by writing a dissertation that's textual, but also by providing a digital format for the dissertation. So here's an example of the chapter on the Ciudad Deportiva that he's worked on.
So one of the things that Peter was talking about was that I want my project to go beyond the text. So I'm producing a traditional dissertation, but I'm also developing a digital dissertation that allows users to go beyond the text and interact with some of the sources that I'm presenting with them. And so one of the ways that I want to play with this is this idea that each paragraph can be written in a different way if you know that the user is going to be interacting with the sources themselves. So here, I've taken some of my earlier work and put some sources behind that. And so this is a website that's built on a generic HTML and CSS framework put out by Twitter called Twitter Bootstrap. And I've plugged one of our in-house pieces of software that we develop here at Matrix called Cora as a digital archive that sits behind that text. So what you're looking at is a website that takes normal HTML and CSS and plugs it into a digital archive which you can then interact with. So what happens is that the reader is able to interact with the text the same way they would with a blog post with all these kind of interactive links, but also they can interact with the sources that I have themselves. So this is an aerial view of the Ciudad Deportiva, and here you see some of the things that I was talking about. These are the 18 tennis courts that were constructed. This is a sort of theme park. A concert pavilion with all the flags of all the nations in the Americas, an enormous cafe and confectionery, a rainbow fountain, and this was an enormous pool in the form of the letter K. And what I can then do is that when I know the reader can look at what I'm actually talking about, and you could put an image into a book and describe it as a paragraph, but you can actually go beyond just the image and view the full record. And then this takes you into the metadata that's associated with that particular object. So the reader is invited to take a look at the sources themselves and see where they pop up in the text. And so here we see other images. This was a giant fish-shaped aquarium that people could walk into and explore. I have various documents, government documents, club documents. And so what I'm playing with the idea here is that how do we take the long form argument of the dissertation that we're trained to produce, and how do we add another layer of depth to that long form argument by exploiting the strengths of the web, which are links, media, and interaction? And that's the question I'm grappling with in the production of the digital dissertation.
Okay, you're also involved in some other digital projects, Alex, some of them with me, and I think it's important to point out also that this kind of research is getting quite a lot of recognition. For example, Alex's research is funded by the Fulbright Fellowship that he recently received through the United States State Department, and also by the World Soccer Body FIFA, which awarded Alex the João Havelange Research Fellowship. So it's I think important to point out again that one can do strong conventional dissertation work, but also try to push the envelope. And doing so is not only risky, but also potentially full of rewards. Tell us a little bit about the Football Scholars Forum and what FSF, as we call it, has been doing, again, in the realm of digital scholarship.
Sure. Well, I think one of the exciting things about the Football Scholars Forum that Peter and I founded in 2010 was that when I arrived here at Michigan State, I very quickly realized that one of my committee members, Peter, was somebody that was connected in all sorts of exciting ways in the field. So I learned about the field of soccer scholarship through Peter's contacts. And then one day, one of our seminars, I thought, wouldn't it be great to use technology to connect to this rich community of soccer scholars, and the idea was quite simple. We originally planned a series of Skype sessions where we would bring authors in to talk about their books, and that format has led to a lot of success and allowed us to transform this project from being something where just football scholars are getting together online to talk about their research to one where they're building a web platform to serve as a venue for their scholarship, to connect their scholarship, and to decide together maybe where their research is going to go. One of the nice things about having this website as well and having it serve as a web platform is that we've started to add resources to the site, which maybe Peter can walk us through, that soccer scholars can use to enhance their research and connect with others.
We have, I think, one of the most exciting resources, a set of course syllabi. When I started out in this field way back in the mid-1990s, there were virtually no courses in the discipline of history that covered soccer in the United States. But now, as you can tell from visiting the FSF site, there are numerous colleagues who are working actively teaching courses in football studies. They come in the discipline of politics or history or sociology, gender studies, development, philosophy, religion. It's really an exciting development. So if you are trying to incorporate soccer material into your courses, you can consult these PDFs in our course syllabi section of the website and maybe develop a unit on the game. Or if you're fortunate enough like us to work in a university where this kind of scholarship is encouraged, you can create your own soccer history, politics, culture course.
I think one of the other things that's very exciting about the Football Scholars Forum is that this interdisciplinarity within academia also extends beyond academia. We have many participants who are journalists, people who are producing stories about soccer in kind of traditional forms of media that we can then start to form a link to. One of the things that excites me about the Football Scholars Forum is that it's a way for academics not only to participate in this interdisciplinary conversation, but also start to re-envision the production of their research for a wider audience.
Well, thank you very much, Alex. As you get ready to go to Buenos Aires, I'm sure you'll see many games at La Bombonera and Monumental and all the wonderful stadiums in that great city. Good luck with your research, and we look forward to seeing the final product. So go well, my friend, and if you want more information, visit footballscholars.org.